Hi, my name is Tibor, and I will present our work on vectorization of line drawings using an integer grid parametrization. This work was done in collaboration with Misha Besmeltow, David Bomes, and Adrian Busseau. In this work, we look at the problem of vectorization of line drawings. So given a bitmap line drawing, such as the one on the left, we want to convert it into a set of parametric curves on the right. This kind of vector representation is often more convenient than a bitmap, because it is resolution independent and more compact in terms of size. It also facilitates editing operations. And moreover, vector curves can be used as an input to a variety of sketch processing algorithms, for instance, for colorization or sketch-based modeling. Especially for rough input drawings, such as this one here, vectorization is a challenging problem. Arguably, the biggest challenge is the proper reconstruction of junctions, which might be very fuzzy in the presence of oversketching. Let's have a look at how the existing vectorization methods cope with these challenges. Many of these methods use skeletonization to vectorize the strokes, which only makes them suitable for clean inputs. An example of this is the method of Norris and colleagues. Favreau and colleagues used a region-based skeleton, which is more robust to oversketching. However, for open curves, they still need to use a classical noisy skeleton. They also employed stochastic optimization, which allows them to merge consecutive curves, but parallel curves cannot be merged. Closest to our method is the method by Besmeltow and Solomon from last year, which traces the streamlines of a frame field in order to obtain a dense set of candidate curves. They, however, use a greedy algorithm to cluster these curves into the final vectorization. We took inspiration from their use of a frame field, but instead of tracing the frame field explicitly, we integrated implicitly using a field-aligned parametrization. An important observation here is that none of these methods is able to merge parallel strokes. Here is a concrete example of a rough input, and you can notice that the existing methods fail to produce the intended topology. One might hope that a possible remedy for this problem would be to pre-process the input drawing, for instance using a deep network, and then feed the simplified bitmap to a vectorization method. The problem is that the existing simplification methods often either break the intended topology or fail to merge some of the strokes. These kinds of artifacts then usually carry over to the vectorization. This is what motivated us to formulate vectorization as a single global parametrization problem, rather than as a series of local problems. The intuition is that most junctions in a typical drawing can be well explained by locally covering the sketch with a deformed grid. The strength of this approach is that nearby strokes with similar directions get snapped to the same grid iso line, and the junctions get snapped to the vertices of the grid. This allows us to reconstruct a clean topology even in the presence of oversketching. To formulate vectorization as parametrization, we took inspiration from quad meshing, where seamless global parametrizations are used to define a quad structure over an input surface mesh. Even though our goal is different, we use the same building blocks, which we adapt for our specific problem. In quad meshing, the edges of a quad mesh are often aligned with sharp features, while we align them with the input strokes. Let's now have a look at our method. Our method adopts a three-step pipeline that is common in parametrization-based quad meshing. Starting from the input drawing, we first compute an orientation field that is locally aligned with the tangent direction in the sketch. We then use this field to compute a field-aligned parametrization whose iso lines closely follow the input strokes. In the last step, we define the topology of the drawing by mapping the isolines back to the sketch space. But of course, before we can do any of this, we first have to discretize the input domain. An obvious choice here would be to simply use the black pixels, and indeed, that's what's been done for instance by Besmalto and Solomon. We have instead decided to work on a triangle mesh with triangle size proportional to the average stroke width. This allows us to decouple the resolution of the drawing from the resolution of the discretization. Similarly to Besmalto and Solomon, we only discretize the narrow band around the black pixels, although we let the user to specify the width of this band according to her desired level of simplification. Now that we have the mesh, we can compute the orientation field, and for that we use a frame field, which locally defines two independent directions. We use the polyvector representation of Diamanti and colleagues, and the field is defined on the vertices of the mesh. We then optimize it using the energy formulation of Besmalto and Solomon. In a nutshell, this energy has three components responsible for smoothness, tangent alignment, and orthogonal regularization. The regularization is important since it prevents the field from collapsing into a line field. However, we have found that the uniform regularization of Besmalto and Solomon can sometimes lead to incorrect field topology around Y-junctions. And this is an issue for us since our parametrization cannot just split an isoline in two. So instead, we define per vertex weights for the regularization term and we initialize them to zero. We then iteratively increase these weights in parts of the sketch where the frame vectors are close to being collapsed. Compared to uniform weights, we have found this strategy to improve the quality of the parametrization. Once we have the frame field, we can compute the parametrization, which we do by minimizing an energy while respecting the hard constraint that the parametrization is seamless. Let's have a look at what that means. The constraint that f is seamless is necessary since in order to compute a global parametrization, the mesh needs to be cut open into disk topology. And we need to make sure that the parametrization satisfies the so-called transition functions at the cuts. I won't go in too deep on how this is done since we follow common practice, so please refer to the paper in case you want more details. Let's now have a look at the energy that we minimize. When computing the parametrization, we have two main goals, and these directly translate into two energy terms, plus a small L2 regularization. The first term is responsible for aligning parametrization isolines with the frame field, and by extension with the input strokes. Here we use a standard Poisson term which simply expresses the fact that a frame should be mapped to the canonical frame. Unlike other vectorization methods, we provide a possibility for the user to control the amount of simplification by scaling the grid. You can see how this works on this simple toy example. If the scale is set to 5, the vertical strokes get merged together. Decreasing the scale to 1 leads to less simplification, which in this case means that no strokes are merged and all of them are reconstructed in the output. On the other hand, if we increase the scale to 10, even the horizontal strokes get merged together. In the demonstration that I just showed, the size of the grid was controlled globally using the parameter gamma. We also provide the possibility to control the scale locally using a mask, and I will show examples of this later in the presentation. This was the first term in our parametrization energy. The second term is responsible for snapping the grid isolines to the input strokes. To understand how we do the snapping, let's consider a single triangle that is lying on an input stroke and has a frame from the computed frame field. We can determine which frame direction is the tangent direction with respect to the stroke, and I will describe how we do that in a minute. Let's say that it's the u direction. This means that we want the vertices of the triangle to be close to an u isoline in the parametric space. And therefore, their parametric v coordinates should be integers. Of course, enforcing this as a hard constraint would create degenerate parametric triangles. So instead, we add this term as a soft penalty by introducing additional integer variables, which represent the isolines. Of course, this works in very much the same way if the tangent direction is v, in which case we add the constraint for u coordinates. In practice, we don't introduce one integer per triangle, since that would significantly increase the computational complexity. Instead, we use a strategy that allows us to eliminate many of the additional integers by snapping adjacent triangles with the same tangent direction to the same isoline. The remaining question for the snapping is how to determine the tangent direction in a frame. The Sobel tangents that we use as frame field alignment constraints are too noisy for determining the tangent direction. So instead, what we do is something different. Let's have a look at this triangle here, for instance. Starting from the triangle, we trace the streamlines in each of the two frame field directions, and we count the number of black pixels encountered by each streamline. The direction with more black pixels is the tangent direction, and in this case, it's the red direction, so we assign a red label to the triangle. Similarly for this triangle, and in this case, the tangent direction is the blue one. We then repeat this for all stroke triangles. The black dots here correspond to cases when the two pixel counts are very close, in which case we leave the triangle unlabeled and we don't use it for snapping. Here is an example of what this labeling looks like for a complete sketch. So these were the two main energy terms in our parametrization energy. We used the weight 25 for the snapping term, which we found to work well in practice. Both the energy and the constraints contain integer variables, and we use Comiso to solve this optimization problem. When the parametrization is computed, the last step of our algorithm is the extraction. And here we adapt the QX algorithm of Epke and colleagues, which maps the grid isolines back to the sketch space using the parametrization inverse. The difference with respect to QX is that we are only interested in extracting the edges and not the quads. Moreover, we only trace edges in the tangent direction, which we identify using the tangent labels computed for the snapping term. The output of this step is a topological graph to which we feed a network of cubic Bezier curves. Let's now have a look at some of our results. On clean input, our method performs similarly to previous work. However, on rough input, we tend to perform better than existing vectorization methods. In fact, our results are often on par with the stroke aggregator simplification of Liu and colleagues. However, their method has more information than ours, since they take vector curves as input, whereas we take a bitmap sketch. As I already said in the beginning, we could try to correct the drawbacks of previous vectorization methods by first filtering the rough input using a bitmap simplification method. And indeed, on an input with more or less uniform amount of oversketching, such as this one here, this often improves the result. However, notice that even here, the bitmap simplification struggles to produce the correct topology, and the resulting vectorization contains artifacts. This is even more evident on inputs with varying levels of sketchiness, such as this house. Here, the bitmap simplification methods either fail to reproduce all details, or fail to merge some of the strokes. Our method can handle even this kind of input. A strength of our method is that the amount of simplification can be controlled locally by changing the scale of the parametrization. So for instance, for this car, uniform scale is not suitable because the car contains multiple levels of detail, and we can see that the strokes around the window were not merged, while a small stroke at the back wheel was missed. We can indicate this to our algorithm by drawing a simple mask, where the orange color means that we want more simplification, and the purple color means less simplification. If we now recompute the parametrization, we can see how the grid size changed in these two areas, and that the final result has improved. In terms of total running time, our method is similar to previous vectorization methods. We might take longer on complex inputs, such as this church, but we are often faster than other methods on simpler sketches with fewer strokes. Our method naturally has its limitations. Since the size of the narrow band is controlled by a global parameter, it might be difficult to find the size that works for the whole drawing. So for instance, if you look at this junction for two different parameter presets, one preset with a smaller band and finer scale, and one with a larger band and coarser scale. And you can see that in this case, the topological graph has a missing edge for a smaller band. On the other hand, this part of the drawing has multiple nearby strokes, and smaller band and scale are more suitable. Moreover, even with the adaptive field regularizer, very sharp junctions might be difficult to capture, no matter the chosen parameters. In conclusion, in this work we drew a parallel between parametrization-based quad meshing and sketch vectorization. Our approach enables joint vectorization and simplification of oversketched inputs, providing clean junctions even in the presence of multiple overlapping strokes. We also provide intuitive control over the scale under which strokes are merged. We focused more on the parametrization and less on the frame field. In future, we would like to improve the behavior of the field around sharp and high valence junctions. We also plan to investigate how the parametrization could be reused and modified locally in order to improve an interactive workflow. For example, let's say that we run our entire method on this cartoon duck and it takes around 36 seconds. Then if we modify the mask, right now we need to recompute the entire parametrization, which takes around 16 seconds, but it's likely that it would be sufficient to just recompute it in the areas affected by the mask. And this would, of course, significantly decrease the update time. Our code is online. Link is in the description, so feel free to try it out, and don't hesitate to reach out if you have any questions. And with that, I thank you very much for watching.